Welcome to the FarmED podcast. My name is Edd Colbert, and today we're recording outside. So currently I'm tucked away in one of the hedgerows, being pricked by brambles overlooking our orchard here at the farm. And I'm joined by James Kempton, who's a PhD at the University of Oxford's Department of Zoology and a farmland bird specialist, who's been doing some great work surveying birds at FarmED. Now you might be wondering what's so important about farmland birds. Isn't farming just about producing food? Well, hopefully we're going to get to the bottom of that today with James, who's been doing some surveying on our farm over the past season. Since FarmED came into the hands of Ian and Celine Wilkinson, we've seen an increase or a doubling of bird species on the land, up to around 84 species at the highest point. So we're really proud that we're creating habitat and the necessary foods for these birds, but maybe there's something we could do more of. So James, welcome to the FarmED podcast.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming. And just to get us started, can you tell us a little bit about yourself and how you came into your love of birds?
Yeah, so it's an absolute pleasure to be here. And so I study birds as part of my PhD, specifically something a little different to this. So I study the control and energetics of albatross flight and falcon flight. But I, as you noted, I also love farmland birds and birds in general. How that came about, I think I was born with a passion and a lot of exposure being outside as a young kid, going bird watching. Since then, I've developed a great interest in ornithology.
Brilliant. Well, it's great to have you here. Before we kind of jump into the work you're doing with FarmED, would it be possible just to share, I know you've been surveying today, some of the species, or perhaps if you've seen anything interesting or rare on the farm today, give us a bit of a sense, and perhaps for the listeners, you might be able to hear some bird song around us at the moment, if you could just share who we're recording with at the moment.
Absolutely, yeah. Actually, we've chosen one of the best locations, I think, to do this recording, because there's a yellowhammer in the background. You can hear the little bit of Brendan O'Cheese's song that Enid Blyton speaks about, and the famous poets John Clare have spoken about for centuries and centuries past. There was a little robin going there. There's the robin. The robin comes along. So two of the species I've seen today, robin and yellowhammer, but also huge flocks of finches. There was about over 200 chaffinches earlier.
And how do you record that? I can't imagine. I mean, these are moving, yeah, flying creatures. How do you record 200?
So one of the things that we're looking at here is supplementary feeding. And so there's actually seed on the ground. So there are periods of over a minute where these finches are stationary on the ground that I can count them. Obviously, I can't count them individually. That's too hard. But one can get a sense of what 5 or 10 chaffinches looks like, say. And then once you have that sense, you can easily extrapolate to go to 50, 100, 200. Okay. So I'd approximate there are about 220 chaffinches at the supplementary feed site earlier today, alongside probably about 25 yellowhammers, 15 brambling, about 50 linnet, and even one corn bunting. Corn buntings are increasingly rare farmland bird species, undergone massive decline. Okay. So it was really pleasing to see one of those.
Yeah, just to have a sense of the typical farm, I mean, I can see the smile on your face as you're recounting these species. Is that a kind of a good diversity of birds, good numbers of birds, or would you expect, is the potential of our farmland birds to be even greater than that?
I think there's a potential to be even greater, but in the context of most of the farms I've visited during my studies in the past 2 months, this is exceptional. The typical farm I go to now, with extremely highly fertilized soil, intensive agriculture, monocultures, I see almost nothing. Okay. There are clouds of birds here this morning, a cacophony of sound. It's beautiful, and as I said, exceptional in many ways. Exceptional to describe it as a brilliant thing, but exceptional also is in nearly unique, because it's very rare, yeah, to see that sort of thing and hear that sort of thing now.
Fantastic. I mean, I've got a growing passion, at least for garden birds, and clearly you have a great passion for all birds, and you've referenced some poets, and throughout kind of cultural history, birds have always appeared as this very beautiful thing to write about, to paint and what have you. But if I'm to be facetious, why should we care about that in terms of a farming system? Are they of any benefit to a farm? Or if we've got people listening who perhaps have those monocultures, high input farms producing lots and lots of food for a growing population, why should we really be caring about farmland birds?
Well, you've already mentioned that they do have a fundamental value to humans for their aesthetic beauty, for their cultural beauty and history. And I think that in and of itself is extremely important and should be valued even in an economic farming context. But on top of that even, they are a critical component of an integrated ecosystem. They have roles in seed dispersal, in predation of pests, to give two examples of the services that they produce, they provide. It's in this sort of context in which a farm can be sustainable and productive in the long term. So while the intensive method might produce good, very good, short-term results, with burgeoning human population to feed, the long term, especially in the context of the climate changes that we are experiencing, is not going to be satisfied by the current farming methods. So it's in that sustainability context that having an integrated approach with the natural biodiversity.
So I guess on the one hand, there's the idea that perhaps these birds or the diversity and number of birds can be an indicator that we have a healthy ecosystem.
Yeah.
And you know, we've spoken in previous podcasts around this link between some farming practices and how they may not have the resilience they currently have with changing climates. But just to kind of come back to that point around insect predation, for example, for a farmer or a land worker, when we see birds out in the field, how can we kind of relate to them in terms of how they might be helping us farm beyond perhaps pest control? How can we see them as part of the farming system as opposed to kind of a separate part of the ecosystem?
Well, I mean, maybe that's just a shift in perspective, really. When one starts to have an environmental scheme as part of the farm that is drawing birds in, and their presence is greater around you, and as you start to associate that then with also the sustainable farming practices and the results of those practices that you're employing, I hope that will create a sense in which they are important to the farming practice that you're undertaking. So, I mean, in terms of saying how you value them more, I think exposure and seeing the results, yeah, which you need monitoring to see, is what's going to bring that sort of own sense of belief that these are important part of the farming practice. Undertaking the schemes and monitoring the results with robust metrics is what needs to be done. And that's what I'm trying to do with some of the surveys that I'm doing at the moment.
Yeah. So at FarmED, we grow wild bird seed mixes, and there's government support for that. So it's a great example of where the government is currently supporting farmers to do things beyond just growing food. We have plenty of hedgerows, wild flower margins, and the supplementary feeding you mentioned earlier, so literally going out and dispersing seed, which in some respects, ideally we wouldn't need to do that, but certainly within the broader landscape we're in here, it's any little extra helps these birds as well. And your work...
We should definitely talk about that, because yeah. I mean, that's what I'm specifically studying here, is the supplementary feeding, and I've been doing that at 10 other farms in the Northeast Cotswold Cluster over these past few months. To specifically understand what the effect of that supplementary feeding is. And it's clear that the supplementary feeding does enhance the bird numbers where those feeding sites are, in contrast to the control plots that I'm looking at. But it's difficult to say exactly what that means, because effectively, in some sense, all you're saying is, well, the birds go where the food is. and that's not a very satisfactory conclusion when you're trying to do this study in the context of how can you increase bird numbers? So this particular project, which is funded by the Farming and Protective Landscapes Grant, which Scott Brown at the Cotswolds National Landscape brought in, hopefully what the surveys I'm doing now are a pilot of that can then show that supplementary feeding helps to bring birds to one site. But then in the long term, I hope that, apparently there's a grant going out at the moment to try and fund this, the landscape recovery pilot bid that the Northeast Cotswold Farm Cluster are putting in, that that is going to extend the monitoring scheme, not just to the individual farm level where I'm looking between control plots and fed plots, but look at the landscape level where we have farms that have supplementary feeding versus farms that don't have supplementary feeding, and also look at the farming practices on those farms. And so what I hope to see then is a transition where the control farms that don't have supplementary feeding but which have sustainable farming practices will have as many birds as, say, those farms that don't have sustainable farming practices but do have supplementary feeding. Yeah. So it's the supplementary feeding is probably a good stopgap in the short term, as you mentioned, but ideally in the long term is not something you're going to be wanting to do.
Yeah.
It's the sustainable farming practice that you want to keep the birds' populations healthy.
It strikes me it's perhaps almost a catalyst in the sense that we're trying to really get birds back into the farming system. And many of these bird species are migratory, so we're trying to catch them on their flights. Well, yep. Not literally catch
no.
them, allure them during their flight paths. But as you say, we want to kind of build up residence over a longer period of time, and that's not going to just come about through feeding. And indeed, if someone was to stop feeding, birds would, as you say, go to where the food is. So by creating that habitat and by farming in a way that is bird-friendly, if we can use that phrase, we can try and actually get a kind of more long-term resilient bird kind of population within the area, right?
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. You're not just. I think with this project, it's not just about luring the birds in with the supplementary feeding initially. It's also about luring the farmers in, because as I was trying to say earlier about shifting the perspective of farmers and how they interact with birds and what value they have to the farms. They're not going to have that perspective until they've seen the birds on their farms and the consequences of having increased bird numbers on their farm. And they're not initially going to have large bird numbers on their farm unless they do something in the short term like supplementary feeding. So this Northeast Cotswold Farm Cluster, for example, that Tim Field has set up, it's got 87 farms on it, and of which 29 are now doing supplementary feeding, and who are seeing, and because of that feeding, they're able to see concentrations in birds in small areas that demonstrates to them that there are a lot of birds here. And that brings them a certain, the reports I've heard firsthand from the farmers is that's bringing them a certain amount of joy to see that they can have farms that have birds on, and that increasing the sustainability of the farming practices is going to even elevate those even higher. So it's about bringing the farmers in as well as the birds.
Yeah,
and this landscape recovery bid that we're putting into DEFRA, which the data I'm collecting now is going to help inform, hopefully that's going to really maximize the number of farms that in the long term, maybe over 15 years, are going to be recording bird data using these sort of surveys, but beyond just the supplementary feeding. So looking at, as I said, on the landscape scale, farms that have feeding, farms that don't, farms that have sustainable practices, farms that don't, and then seeing if that leads to an increase in the number of bird species, absolutely, and relative to those farms that don't have the sustainable farming practices.
Yeah, and just if we can unpack those sustainable farming practices a little bit, then just to have a think about beyond supplementary feeding, are there any other, not necessarily quick wins, but any top tips that you could give for farmers who might be thinking about creating more habitat or providing a sustenance for these birds?
Yeah, well, so farmland birds in the last 40 years have gone down by about 75% in absolute abundance. We think. And probably one of the main reasons for this is the intensification of agriculture, which has led to a reduction in the diversity of plants that exist, the diversity of seeds that are available to winter farming birds. So certainly increasing the diversity of crop is going to be a very important thing. Definitely something that can be implemented by farmers. But I mean, I'm not a farmer myself, so I don't know exactly how the most economically feasible ways to do that are, but maybe I'd...
Yeah, so I guess the message is sort of diversity begets diversity. If we can have a diversity of landscape function, diversity within our cropping systems, that's going to be mirrored by the biology out there, not just birds, but much broader categories of species. Bring it to a close now, because it's getting a little bit chilly out here in the orchard. You mentioned at the beginning your passion and interest in albatross flight and falcon flight. And I know that also kind of links into thinking about more sustainable futures. Could you just share a little bit about that work you're doing?
Sure. So we're talking about sustainability in farming here today, principally. But I'm also interested in sustainability of travel and of the services we employ in general. So the albatrosses are extraordinary birds and their relatives. So people in the UK might know the shearwater, for example, the Manx shearwater, which is a relative of the albatross. Both of these species use this amazing flight technique called dynamic soaring, which enables them to harvest the energy and the wind gradient that exists above the sea surface. So people might be familiar with the thermal soaring of buzzards and red kites, where they're exploiting the updrafts of warm air. But over the sea surface, these shearwaters and albatrosses are exploiting the gradient in the wind that is caused by the friction between the wind and the sea surface. And albatrosses can fly up to 1,000 kilometers a day, often for hours at a time, not flapping, because they're harvesting energy from this wind field. And if we can have, for example, gliders, drones that perform important social functions, whether that be search and rescue, coastal search and rescue, maintenance of coastal shipping services, weather monitoring services, a whole range of important offshore services that humans depend on, could that be implemented by freely gliding drones that don't need batteries, which usually limit drone flight to about 20 minutes, then you have a very powerful, sustainable system. And you can employ that more generally. You can have drones connected to ropes, which then drive turbines that could exploit a wind field on land.
Amazing.
So it's the sort of the energetics of the albatross flight and its sustainability, and applying that to man-made technology that's really interesting to me, and which links together to the general theme of sustainability.
Yeah, well, that's really amazing to hear, and also lovely to hear a bird lover also speak about drones with such passion. They don't normally go hand in hand. No, it's been really wonderful talking and learning, and I think kind of a key message for me, both in terms of the farmland birds and these albatross, is the way in which we can look to nature to inform us as indicators for good design, or indeed indicators of a healthy ecosystem.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's certainly something at FarmED we're really trying to share with people, to think beyond these terms of weeds and pests and birds, and actually begin to understand what's the message underneath these various characteristics in the landscape, and what can they tell us about how we're managing things. So thanks very much, and we look forward to seeing the results this year.
Yeah, absolute pleasure. Thank you, Edd.